the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, He the perfect Son of Man, in His living, in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in Him we stand. Mystery, Christ the Lord upon the tree, in the stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain Him, praise the Lord, He is alive. In power resurrected, as will we be when He comes. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain Him, praise the Lord, He is alive.
Save Evening, folk. Nice to see you out on our Maundy Thursday communion service. We will be ready in a moment. We didn't have enough faith, so we'll have to bring some more cups out. that'll teach us, won't it? But it's good on this Passion Week to stop and remember and to give thanks for all the Lord has done for us. And we're going to sing together just the most appropriate hymn that we can start with. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. And normally I said, if you can't stand, that's okay, but how can you sing this and not stand? And when it tells you, you should, but that's okay, you can take a seat. but let's stand if we're able, and let's sing to the glory of God.
Jesus the Master.
Those words are just powerful. He took my sin, my sorrow. He made them his very own. The one who knew no sin, in whose spirit there was no guile. He bore the burden of Calvary, and he suffered and he died alone. No wonder we should stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. Let's pray. Father, forgive us when those words just roll off our tongue. Help us to understand the truth we have just sung. Help us to grasp and comprehend in part what it meant for you, the Holy One, to bear away our sin. We know the theology. And for all tonight, we know the reality of what that has done in our hearts and in our lives. We thank you for your saving grace. We thank you for your love poured into our hearts. But Lord, we would simply ask that you'd lead us back to Calvary. Help us to comprehend something of the amazing love that held Christ on that cross. Lord, we thank you that while the old hymn put it, while he was on the cross, I was on his mind. And that's something to just bamboozle our hearts and our minds. That you thought of us enough and loved us enough that you would go through that to bring us into a right relationship with yourself. And Lord, we pray that you will never let us forget the cross or Calvary. And you will help us to live at the foot of the cross. We realize that tonight the only madman thing in heaven were the nail prints that hung him to the cross. And for all eternity, we will give thanks and we will praise and we will give wonder to the Lamb who was slain. But it is marvelous, it is wonderful to us tonight. Your love for us, your redeeming grace that has picked us from the pit of sin, stripped us of our own self-righteousness and clothed us in the robes of your Son's righteousness. That tonight we are allowed into your presence as sons and daughters of the Most High. And we can bow in worship and in admiration, and we can give thanks. Father, as we spend this time together, as we meditate on the cross, melt our hearts again. Bend our wills again, so that we might submit to the man of the cross. And help us to bring glory to him and to him alone. For we ask it in his precious name. Amen. You got a Bible? I want you to open with me, please, to Luke 23. It's not that we've skipped a whole... but by the time we get to Luke 23, it'll be a couple of years, so you'll have forgot this sermon. Luke 23. Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payments of the taxes to Caesar and claims to be the Messiah, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis for a charge against this man." But they insisted, "He stirs up people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee, and he's come all the way here." On hearing this, Peter asked if he was a man from Galilee. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform a sign of some sort. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him, dressed him in an elegant robe, and sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends, because before this they had been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests and the rulers of the people and said to them, "You brought this man as one who is inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and find no basis for your charges against him. Neither is Herod, for he sent him back to me. He has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and release him." But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man. Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown in prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again. But they kept shouting, "Crucify him. Crucify him." For the third time, he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore, I have punished him and then released him." But they shouted with loud shouts, they intently demanded he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for. And he surrendered Jesus to their will. Is that little verse, those two little verses, I want to just think on for a short little time tonight. Verses 20 and 21. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again. But they kept shouting, "Crucify him. Crucify him." A modern American writer by the name of Sam Johnson has written this: "Whereas I affirm the need for proper self-image, I fear that many are fast becoming so impressed with themselves that they can't but wonder why Jesus had to die for them at all. But when we look at Scripture, Jesus was on the cross suffering the eternal penalty we deserved because of the infinite holiness of God and because of the depths of our depravity." It's a question I was just put to me just the other week, actually, in the market. I didn't ask Jesus to die for me. Why would I need him? I'm okay. So impressed with themselves, so impressed with their own good works, so impressed with their own morality. They don't need Jesus. But Jesus has been beaten, he's been mocked, he's been scorned. And Pilate, bless him, Pilate wants to release him three times. He says, I see nothing wrong with this man. Let him go. But egged on by the religious leaders, the crowd cried, "Crucify him." But I wonder today, do we fully understand what that means? Do we understand what crucifixion really means? Don Carson puts it like this. 2,000 years of pious Christian tradition has largely domesticated the cross, making it hard for us to realize how to view Jesus and his death in our time. And we have domesticated the cross. Nothing wrong with wearing it, but that's what we think it is, or that's what we think it is. Both the painful and the shameful, we're going to look at tonight, aspects of the crucifixion have become to us in our day and generation blurred. No matter what we may think we know about the manner of his execution, it simply does not mean the same as it did to those in the first century. Their understanding of crucifixion is very different than ours. And the New Testament itself provides very little information concerning the details of the crucifixion. All four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, simply just all say the same thing, and they crucified him. Why is there so little record for us? Well, there are at least two reasons. One, the crucifixion was so frequent, everybody then knew exactly what it was. They were familiar with what was going on. People were, in the first century, all too painfully familiar with the sight of a crucifixion. But more importantly, the fact that the crucifixion was so utterly repugnant, so indescribably shameful, that they deemed it improper to go beyond the bare minimum of describing the Lord's experience. All four gospel writers just simply put it, they crucified him. So let's try and de-domesticate. It's not good grammar, but it's good theology. What it meant. Three very simple little things. The cross was a place of pain. We must remember that the theological significance of the cross cannot be separated with the historical and with the physical event. We know what the cross did for us. We know that the cross bought our redemption. We know that Christ paid our atonement on the cross, but it was still a physical, it was still a historical event that took place. And there were many different variations to the cross. Lots of people were crucified in the shape of an X. The vast majority were crucified in the shape of a T. That's why we have what we have on the wall. But the height of the cross was important. The victim's feet would be no more than 1 or 2 feet off the ground. It would never be at that height. It would be far lower. The reason? So that wild beasts and scavenger dogs, who were normal in the city of Jerusalem, could feast on the corpse. It's graphic, it's brutal, it's sickening, but that's the reality. One historian put it this way, punishment with limbs outstretched. They see the stake as their fate. They are fashioned and nailed to it in the most bitter torment, evil food for birds and prey for the wild animals. It's the most painful way to die. And the nails simply impaled the victim to the tree. In 1968, they were excavating one of the cemeteries in Jerusalem as an archaeological dig. And they came across a skeleton. Actually, you go to the Jerusalem Museum, you'll see it. And they called the skeleton John. And he was on a cross. They didn't bother taking him off. They just dumped his body, and his body was preserved. The feet were joined a cross parallel, both transfixed by one nail through the heel. The legs were adjacent, the knees were doubled. The trunk, his body was contorted. His arms were freakishly stretched beyond what was normal. Historians tell us that often it's called a sallusta. It's a little block of wood. So if that was the cross and we brought it down to just about this height, you would take a little block, roughly the size of a brick, and you would put it there, just in the middle of the man's back, the crucified person's back. So while impaled on the cross, you could, if you used all your strength, lift yourself enough just to rest on it for a moment. But exhaustion would take over, and then your body would shudder again. It was placed there to make the whole crucifixion last longer, to prolong the victim's agony. The precise cause of Jesus' death has been debated for years. Don Carson summarizes, whether tied or nailed to the cross, the victim endured countless paralysis as he pulled his arms and pushed his legs and kept his chest cavity open for breathing and collapsed in exhaustion, the scourging, the loss of blood, the shock, the agony. Could go on for days, ending with, at last, suffocation, cardiac arrest, blood loss. It's hard to imagine a more hideous form of capital punishment. Crucifixion was believed to be an effective deterrent in the ancient world and was frequently used. Stephen, why do you have to be so graphic? Because that's the pain he suffered for you and me. And if we think any less of it, then we have domesticated the cross. And God forbid. But the greatest agony that Christ faced on the cross was not that. The greatest agony he faced, Matthew records, about 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The cross is a place of pain. The cross is a place of shame. Worse than the pain of the cross was the shame of the cross. The Apostle Paul, when writing to the church in Corinth, says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, it is the power of God." And then verse 23, "But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews, and foolishness to the Gentiles." Question is, you have to ask, why does Paul refer to the cross as foolishness? A stumbling block. It isn't because the concept or the practice of the crucifixion was intellectually incoherent or illogical. It's not like 2 + 2 = 5. Rather, the message of salvation through faith in a crucified Savior, that's what was deemed foolishness. That's what the stumbling block was. Because the cross was itself the embodiment, the emblem of the most hideous of human obscenities. The cross was a symbol of reproach, was a symbol of degradation, of humiliation, of disgust. It was visually repugnant. In other words, the cross was obscene. And by the way, victims on the cross were normally crucified naked. it was Jewish sensitivities that demanded that they wear a loincloth. But in biblical terms, physical nakedness was a symbol often used of shame and dishonor. As John Calvin wrote like this, the evangelist, talking about John's gospel, portrays the Son of God stripped of his clothes. Here's the reason: that we may know the wealth gained for us by his nakedness. For it shall dress us in God's sight. God willed his Son to be stripped that we should appear fully clothed in his Son's righteousness. Get it for a moment. It's our shame, our dishonor, our sin that has left us naked before God. But Christ was willing to be stripped so that we might be clothed in him. Calvin was right. The first Adam originally created in the righteousness of God, but his sin stripped him naked and us. The last Adam suffered the shame of nakedness by his obedience, clothes us in the righteousness of God. The tables have turned. You see, in the ancient world, if you went to a Greek theater and you watched these great Greek plays, these great Greek tragedies, often the heroine or the hero was routinely crucified. But at the last moment in every single one of those plays, something would happen that they would be rescued and they would be set free and they wouldn't have to suffer the shame of a death on a cross. That's why the Greeks thought it was foolishness that Jesus died. If he was a real hero, then why would God ever allow that to happen? And by the way, the obscenity of the cross explains Paul or Saul of Tarsus's early opposition to the church. Isn't how Saul describes his opposition to the church? He was ravaging against the church, Acts 8. That simply means, it literally refers to a wild beast ripping it apart, flesh from bone. That's how Paul, or Saul as he was, took on the church. Acts 9, he says, his words, he breathed murderous threats. Acts 22, his words, he persecuted to the point of death. Acts 26, his testimony, he was furiously enraged at the church. Galatians 1:13 tells us he wanted to destroy the church. Why? It wasn't because primarily Jesus claimed to be the Son of God. It wasn't primarily because Saul saw him as a threat to the law of Moses or to the temple. The principle and the reason why Saul of Tarsus let such fury out against the church is because the cross was a stumbling block. A crucified Messiah was a contradiction in terms. One may have a Messiah, one may have a crucifixion, but one cannot have a Messiah who's been crucified. That was Paul's thinking. You see, the concept of a Messiah invokes power, splendor, triumph. But the picture of a crucifixion, weakness, degradation, defeat. The cross is a symbol of pain. The cross is a symbol of shame. And the cross was seen as a curse. in the Jewish law, in Deuteronomy 21:23, you must not leave the body hanging on a pole overnight. Be sure to bury it in the same day, because anyone who is hung on a pole, cross, is under God's curse. You must not desecrate the land the Lord your God has given you as an inheritance. The words were also applied to Jesus' day to anyone who was crucified. That's why the Jews demanded that Jesus' crucifixion be banished. His body be taken down, he be finished off. Why? Because Paul tells us, Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. But see, the cross was the only way of salvation. The cross shows us the seriousness of our sin, but it shows us the immeasurable love of God. Sin was conquered at the cross. I agree with Don Carson's. We have largely domesticated the cross. We don't want to think because it's too horrible, it's too gruesome. But he suffered pain. He suffered shame. And he suffered a curse. For you and for me. Tell me how much he loves me. This much. The life of Christ, as we've been going through Luke on a Sunday morning, I hope you've noticed, it's a beautiful thing. But can I suggest the cross of Christ is more beautiful even still? One old hymn writer put it like this. Christ does not save us, save men by his life, though that was holy, sinless, and pure. Not even by his tender love, though that's forever will endure. He does not save them by his words, though they shall never pass away, nor by vast creative power that holds the elements in sway. He does not save them by his works, though he was ever doing good. The awful need was greater still. It took his death, his cross, his blood. That's what saves us. His death, his cross, his blood. In a moment, we're going to sing that awesome hymn. When I survey the wondrous cross. Can I ask that we de-domesticate it? And ask that the Lord would help us understand, in part, what it meant when they simply wrote, and they crucified him. And they crucified him for you. Let's sing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Please take a seat. We're going to pray together. And we're going to have an open time of prayer. And let's just bow and thank the Lord for the cross. And let's thank him for what he did there for you and for me. Someone feel free to lead us, and then two or three, and then in a little while, I'll bring our time to a close.
Dear Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we thank you for your love and grace. We thank you for Jesus Christ, our Saviour, who came down from heaven to die on that cruel cross so that we might have forgiveness of our sins through his blood. May we remember this every day and give heartfelt thanks for the cross and the empty tomb. Soon many people will be thinking of Easter and celebrating in their different ways. Lord, may they come to know the true meaning of Easter and open their hearts to the truth that Jesus saves. We pray for the brothers and sisters in Christ will be going in on the streets of Exeter and Exmouth to have conversations, give the gospel and tracts. May hearts be opened, Lord. We pray for all in our neighbourhood. They see us coming to church. May they at this special time have the desire to come and find out what this Jesus is all about. What is that that brings us to worship time after time? We will be happy to give them the good news. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Oh Father, we just give you thanks and we give you praise. We praise you, Almighty God. We thank you for the sacrifice of your only Son, Jesus Christ. Reminded of the scripture that tells us that there was no comeliness about him. He was despised, he was shamed, he was through that shame for us. But yet the chastisement of our sins was upon him, and by his stripes we were healed. We thank you, Lord. We thank you as we've been taught that his nakedness clothed us with righteousness. We thank you for the blood that was shed for us. We thank you for the power in the blood of Jesus. We thank you, Father. We thank you for the sacrifice. We just magnify your name. We lift your name up this evening, Lord. We glorify you. We thank you, Father, for that sacrifice. And we thank you for the life that we have in you. We thank you for the freedom it gives us. For whom you set free, O Lord, is free indeed. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.
We thank you, Jesus, for your obedience to the Father and what you did and how you just followed and you sweat blood drops and you pleaded and you were obedient and you gave your life for us. I want to thank you so, so much for the death on the cross. And that you took the place what should have been me. And that you replaced and you died for all of us. And I thank you so much for that. Amen.
We live in a very wicked world. And if it wasn't for your Son who died on the cross for us, this wicked world would have consumed us, not only spiritually, but also physically. We fight every day to raise your name in gloriness, to tell the world there's a forgiveness, there's an amazing person, the God's Son that died on the cross for us, who shed his blood for us, so we can wake up renewed in his love every day. Oh God, please protect us against this wickedness. And I want to say thank you. Thank you so much for leading me to this church to show me the path. That the world is not always so wicked, but there is this bright light that shines. We don't always see it. We don't see it when we're depressed. We don't see it when we're lonely. But we know it's there. And coming here tonight, praying with this congregation, reminds me again that your Son, that died on that cross, who shed that blood for me, did not go in vain. Because you do love me. And I do love you so very much. Thank you so much. Amen.
Father, we thank you that in eternity past, the cross was planned for our redemption, to deal with our depravity, to deal with our sin, our nakedness, our shame. That pain, that curse should have been ours. I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. I should have hung on that cross in disgrace, but Jesus, God's Son, praise God, took my place. Help us, O Lord, to eternally appreciate the cross of Christ for all that it is and all it achieved. For we ask it in his Son's name. Amen. On the night before he was betrayed and crucified, he took bread and broke it. This is my body, broken. Take, eat, in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup. This is the cup of the new covenant. This is what clothes us. This is what cleanses us. Take, drink, in remembrance of me. little chorus has been going through my head all day. I'm not going to sing it. I wish I could. Wounded for me. Wounded for me there on the cross. He was wounded for me. Gone my transgressions. And now I am free. All because Jesus was wounded for me. We drink in thankfulness to him tonight. Can we sing? How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure. Didn't know I was a ventriloquist, did you? Before we close in prayer, thanks for coming out tonight. But I trust the Lord will keep us near the cross and give us a greater understanding day by day of what that means. You're all welcome back on Saturday morning for breakfast, 9 o'clock. If you haven't signed in, that's okay. Just tell Hannah, there's enough food. And please come. We share a little devotional on Saturday morning, then both services on Sunday. Little heads up, clocks go forward, so don't be late for church. All right, do not walk in halfway through my sermon, because I will name you and shame you. And you know I would. And that's not a challenge, by the way. And it will be great. And then pray for tomorrow night. I was going to say, lovingly, the vast majority of you are the wrong age. And but pray for our family event tomorrow night for the kids as we teach them what Easter really means. There is a March of Witness tomorrow morning at 10 at the cathedral. I have no idea who's preaching, so that is a disclaimer on my part. But that is at the cathedral at 10, and then followed by a March of Witness for those who would wish to go. Let me close in prayer. Lord, it is a precious thing just to take time around your table and in your word, and to spend time, most importantly, in your presence. Help us, O Lord, has been prayed already tonight, to so declare the cross and the resurrection of Christ, not just this weekend, but every weekend and every day. Because without the cross, we would have no hope. Without the resurrection, we would have no life. But thanks be to God that death has been conquered, sin has been defeated, and Christ is victorious. For every head bowed, for every home represented, guard us and keep us. Use every opportunity you give us this weekend, tomorrow night with the kids and the families, on Saturday, on Sunday. Give us souls for our labor. Bring folk in who need to hear. But Lord, give us the grace to go out and tell them. And then rely on the grace of God to transform their lives. Now may that grace, that mercy, and that peace follow, guide, and lead each and every one of us. For we ask it in your Son's precious name. Amen.